everyone. Thank you guys for coming and for being patient with our minor setbacks. Ms. Packer hopefully will be joining us momentarily. We're going to go ahead and get started just to keep us within our hour timeline. We're just going to go down. Oh, here she is.
Good morning.
Good morning, Ms. Packer.
Perfect time.
Perfect time. All right, so Ms. Packer, if you want to come over and give us a opening remarks.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you so very much for all being here on a really important topic. And I'm to give a few opening remarks on a subject that needs more attention. So we want to welcome you and thank you all for joining us today. As we explore the important opportunity before us this summer, the chance to renegotiate NAFTA. I particularly want to thank each of our panelists for taking the time to educate us on their vast experiences on what NAFTA promised, what it delivered, and what we should fight for within the agriculture sector to better ensure outcomes. You may not realize how massive that sector really is. I want to thank Sister Simone Campbell, Executive Director of Network, who's actually a registered lobbyist for Catholic Social Justice. So Laura Carlson, the Director of the Americas Program at the Center for International Policy. Thank you for being here. Karen Hansen, Chief Director of Trade and Global Governance at the Institute for Agriculture and Trade Policy. Thank goodness you exist. To Abel Nunez, Executive Director of CARESEM, the Latino Resource and Justice Center for America. Thank you for being here this morning. Mark Weisbrook, Co-Director of the Center for Economic and Policy Research. And finally, Patrick Woodall, Research Director and Senior Policy Advocate at Food and Water Watch, and how well I know your organization. You do great work, all of you. It is important to remember that NAFTA's impact has been uneven across commodities and laborers within the trading bloc. From a macro scale perspective, this trade deal has actually been good for agriculture writ large. Today, however, we hope to peel back the layers of the onion to explore the nuances of the deal and how certain communities bore the brunt of negative impact. It is estimated by the U.S. Department of Agriculture that every dollar of agricultural exports adds roughly $1.27 billion to the, every dollar of agricultural exports, we add about $1.27 to our own economy. So agriculture is a top priority for American exports, and our renegotiations must be reflective of that reality. But while these numbers are good news for the United States agribusiness, which today is having some of its own challenges, I might say, they've been ruinous for Mexican farmers who can't compete. In fact, on my desk I have a cob of white corn that I brought back from Oaxaca many years ago to remind me of the struggle of the people in Mexico. In Mexico itself, there's no unemployment insurance. There are few alternatives for work elsewhere, and without question, within NAFTA itself, there were no readjustment provisions on our continent for what would happen to those who in agriculture basically lost their livelihoods. And those numbers count up into the millions, not the hundred thousands, the billions. The agreement opened Mexico to U.S. imports by phasing out tariffs that were once triple digit for many products. A decade into the trade agreement, Mexico became the top destination for U.S. beef, with the volume of shipments nearly five times greater than before the agreement. Pork imports from the United States doubled in NAFTA in the first decade. U.S. chicken imports also soared, making Mexico the third biggest U.S. chicken export market. U.S. corn imports account for about 30% of Mexico's market, And therein lies part of the hidden tragedy of what happened in Mexico, though it was a boom for the United States, whose farmers were 18 times more efficient than those of Mexico. 4 decades ago, Mexico's rice farmers supplied all of its country's needs. These days, about 80% of rice consumed in Mexico is imported, and almost all of that comes from the United States. NAFTA's impact on the agriculture industry in all three nations, Mexico, Canada, and the United States, has been transformed to meet market demands and promote the interests of large agribusiness corporations at the expense of farmers and farm communities. Perhaps more than any other sector, NAFTA accelerated the transfer of wealth from local farmers to transnational corporations. And I can remember an incident in Oaxaca when I was visiting Countryside Can't Take It Anymore, which is an organization that exists in Mexico. And the locals were showing me how all of their children were moving to America to work in our fields and sending money back through remittances. But they were desperately trying to build little tortilla factories to create some enterprise in that area, and how very difficult it was, and how harsh the meeting of markets was on the hundreds of thousands of people who lived in that area. Incidentally, when they would go to try to get the remittances that their kids were sending from the United States, I learned that 40% of those remittances were actually lost in the transfer. So if you were sending a remittance back, you were charged 20% by Western Union here, 20% by Western Union in Mexico City, and 40% of the median wage was lost. Really shocking. And I suggested setting up a credit union between our region and their region so that we could move toward a more fair market reality. And the people that I spoke with, including some parliamentarians in Mexico, were scared to death to do that because they said, if we handle money, we're likely to be shot. And so we are afraid to manage this in this community. Today, with the internet and with certain capabilities that exist, perhaps there's a better answer, but that problem remains. But in any case, the transfer of wealth that occurred is highlighted by the loss of about 2 million jobs in Mexico tied to agriculture, with millions more displaced as imported subsidized corn wiped out small farmers. A direct result was the increase in immigration to the United States from Mexico by 79% in the first decade following its passage. There are some labor economists who believe that what occurred was willful, and that what the United States was actually seeking was cheap labor with no rights. In Mexico today, many small towns are inhabited mostly by women and the elderly, because working age men fled to the United States looking for jobs, the vast majority crossing over illegally. And it has been very discouraging to me to be a member of Congress and listen to the immigration debate and never hear the word NAFTA brought up. And the major propellant it was for the challenge we face. And believe me, when it was first passed and I was here, we tried desperately to get agricultural adjustment provisions in the body of the agreement. It was impossible. Given these realities, we must approach renegotiations of NAFTA with an eye to address inequality and the alleviation of poverty. A people-first agenda means creating an environment where small farmers are not forced to migrate to ensure that their families can survive, where workers receive living wages that are continentally established, that allow them to compete against corporate interests, and finally, where consumers have access to healthy and affordable foods. I hope you will all enjoy hearing from our panelists today to help enlighten the debate that may occur as we attempt to renegotiate NAFTA, which is about how many years late now? 25, a quarter century late. Thank you so very much for being here today.
I have to say that block.
Congresswoman, you deserve a great credit for your focus and capacity to hold attention when we have this live stream going on over. Fabulously done. So, just affirming that, thank you. Hopefully, I can pick up on what Congresswoman Capner was saying, because I'm Sister Simone Campbell. I'm the executive director of Network, a lobby for Catholic social justice. I got some notoriety for leading a campaign called Nuns on the Bus, and we've traveled the country making mischief around income and wealth disparity in our nation. And what we know as an organization is that, from our studies, is NAFTA and the trade agreements have been part of what has fueled, part of the story of what has fueled our income and wealth disparity in our nation and in our hemisphere. So I'm really grateful for this chance to talk a little bit about our experience. But let me note, I am not the academician or the one who does all of the data dive. I'm here really because for my 50 years as a Catholic sister, I've worked at the economic margins of our nation and our world. My religious community, the Sisters of Social Service, we have sisters in the US, Mexico, Taiwan, and the Philippines. And I was the leader of my community in those four nations when NAFTA took effect. And what I saw was the devastation of our sisters in Mexico and their families. And it's that account that I want to share with you. So what I have seen comes from the state of Michoacán, a lovely hilly area which is not good for agribusiness. Some ways we could say thank heavens, because otherwise it would have plowed flat and brought in the big, you know, tractors. I'm obviously a city girl because I don't know all the things they bring in. But the fact is, it's hilly, and so most of the land has to be plowed pretty simply, with small tractors, still done often with burros, in small plots of land. But what happened with NAFTA, with the corn prices for the principal commodity in Michoacán is corn, but it forced those prices onto the international market. Without the tariffs, without the protections, my sister's families could no longer support themselves on their pedagos. In the ranchos or in the ejidos, they could not survive. And so what happened was, their men began to say, we've got to do something else. We need to support our families. And the Mexican government was advertising NAFTA. Great opportunities in Monterrey or in the maquilas up at the border. And so the men said, we have to move. That left the women to take up the role of farming, which was not their historical role. And it created a great disequilibrium in the family in Mexico, in the state of Michoacán. What we know is that this fueled the significant migration. So all of my sisters in Mexico, in the state of Michoacán, three towns, Morelia, Camarillo, and Zacapu, each one of them has at least a few men in the U.S. without documents for their families to survive. Now, this was, you know, they established a rhythm, they work, they send money home. And prior to the crackdown on the border, they would come home every Christmas. And at Christmas, they'd bring presents from the U.S. They'd try to fit back into their families. It was often very tense. They'd be home for 3 or 4 weeks, usually conceiving a child in the wonderful reunion of the family. And then they'd return to the U.S. and their job. Nowadays, that's no longer possible with the crackdown on the border. People desperate to feed their families are kept off of their ancestral lands because they cannot go home. And because they cannot go home, we have families broken apart, which has resulted in a wide variety of problems. And, kids getting into trouble, missing their dads, young people leaving home really young to come
the unaccompanied minor reality from Mexico is in part because of that, trying to reunite with fathers. Well, it's so bad that one of our young Mexican sisters was able to see her brother for the first time in 6 years this Pentecost, which is my community's big feast, when she came to the States on a religious visa. Her brother had left a wife and child in Mexico to come to the U.S. He works full-time here. He pays his taxes. He's a credit to his community, but he's unable to visit his family because of border crossing issues. He is a hard-working agricultural worker. He'd love to do it at home, but he can't. It's this intersection of trade policy and forced migration that the U.S. Congress has refused to address in refusing to fix our broken immigration system. So now in the state of Michoacán, there are families permanently registered. Our sisters are working with these families. We're social workers. We work with these families, and our sisters are trying to support them by educating them what it means to go north, what the risks are, what your rights are if you get into the U.S., what the danger of the trip is about. And one of our sister's relatives was even kidnapped by a coyote and helping him cross the border. And the family had to raise money to free him. This family was lucky. Their relative was returned. But our sisters were also trying to create microenterprises as an alternative to migration so these families don't have to be torn apart. They went to the state government to get a little seed money to make this possible. And the state in Morelia said, "Oh, madrecita, no te preocupes." It's always bad when a government official calls you madrecita. It just means like, "Oh, little sister." They pat you on the head and you want to not respond in a very thoughtful way. And what they said was, it's a federal issue. So our sisters go to the feds in Mexico City. And they said, "Oh no, we couldn't do that. The second most important in revenue source for our nation are the remittances. If we undercut remittances, we undercut the rural economy. And if we do that, we'll have unrest in the countryside, and that would not be good for our nation. Better our people are outside our nation than we create small economies here." It was shocking to them, and it's shocking to me. And we need to address this reality in the NAFTA renegotiation. NAFTA is geared for big business, big agriculture. It's not geared for the people. And ironically, there's two bills being introduced today on the criminalization of migration without ever addressing the causes. So we say that a post-NAFTA experience on both sides of the border is precarious for families, small corporations, small businesses, governments, small agricultural enterprises. It's created disequilibrium in our cities and rural areas of the signatory nations. And I urge the committee to explore the real consequences of this trade agreement. Pope Francis says that to be faithful, the economy must serve the people, not the other way around. I join my prayer with his when he says, quote, "We need then to find ways by which all may benefit from the fruits of the earth, not only to avoid the widening gap between those who have more and those who must be content with the crumbs, but above all, because it is a question of justice, equality, and respect for every human being." I urge this committee to thoroughly look at the consequences of NAFTA, and let's make a change.
Good morning, thank you to Congresswoman Capter's office for organizing this important event. My name is Laura Cross, and I'm the director of the Americas Program at the Center for International Policy. I've been in Mexico City and Oaxaca for the last 30 years, and have been working on NAFTA since the beginning of the negotiations. Today, I want to build a little, very briefly, on the overview that Congresswoman Capter gave us. In 4 points. The first is that NAFTA, that Mexico did not win under NAFTA. First of all, Mexico is facing a situation, has been almost since the agreement went into effect, of low growth and high poverty in the agricultural sector especially. Mexican growth overall has averaged only 2.3% over the NAFTA period to date, and it's been totally insufficient to create the jobs that are needed, especially taking into account the farmers that have been pushed off their land as a result of imports from the United States. The growth rate in the agricultural and livestock sector, if the overall rate was low, has been even lower, approximately 1.5% on an annual average. The number of people in living in poverty grew under NAFTA. The latest figure we have from 2014 is 55.3%, and there are many methodologies that believe that these figures, these poverty figures, are grossly understated. Within that, 28 million men, women, and children experience hunger, known as food poverty, and the irony of it is that these people are concentrated in the rural areas where food is or was produced. Agriculture's contribution to the gross national product has dropped from 5 to 1.5%. What are the reasons for the devastation, which is the word that campesinos, peasant farmers use in Mexico for what's happened to them under NAFTA? First, clearly, it's the flood of imports. The industrial production in the hands of transnational corporations, there's been an extreme concentration since NAFTA went into effect. And this has also meant a loss of livelihoods and a loss of food sovereignty. Food sovereignty, very briefly, is defined as the ability to produce and obtain the food that a nation needs to feed its people, as well as producing the livelihoods that the rural sector needs. From near self-sufficiency in the staple corn in Mexico, Mexico now imports a third of its corn, almost all of it from the United States, and 46%, nearly half, of all of its basic foods. This year, that came to a record almost 14 million tons of corn. Mexico actually has a negative balance of trade in agriculture. In the last few years, it's been positive with the United States because of an increase in avocado, but overall it's negative. And we also have to take into account that this line between exports and imports is really a blurred line and cannot be seen just on the basis of individual nations. Because, for example, Cargill and ADM and the big transnational corporations that have come in to be producers, exporters, and importers in Mexico are playing all these roles and are the ones who are benefiting most from NAFTA. It's really a myth to set one country against each other when we have this kind of a discussion. They're also, even despite being kind of the face of free trade in the sector, these transnational corporations for whom the rules were written, they are also the ones that are receiving hundreds of millions of dollars in subsidies from both the United States and Mexico. The second, and this has been mentioned, and it's very important in U.S. policy, is this link between the loss of livelihoods and migration. As U.S. exports to Mexico rose, producer prices plummeted because their own domestic market was flooded. This affects even producers who are largely subsistence farmers because they have to sell their surplus for the things that they don't produce on their tiny farms. The latest figures show a loss of 4.9 million jobs, which meant that they calculate some 6 million people of working age were forced to leave the countryside. This includes migration to the cities as well as migration to the United States. And as was mentioned, it's been very important is that oftentimes it leaves women in charge of trying to make a living by producing products that now have producer prices that are frequently below the price of production and living off a combination of that and remittances. You can go to towns, pueblos in Mexico, where you practically only see women of working age in those towns, and it's a very, very difficult situation to keep families together and to survive on what they have. The immigration rate to the United States soared, as many of you know, to half a million people a year during the peak years. It's leveled off recently, mainly it has followed the job market in the United States. However, there's still a large number of families that are divided because of that displacement from the farms. On the other side, undocumented workers make up half to three quarters of the 2.5 million farmers in the United States. These are people who are unable to exercise basic labor and human rights, and they live now especially under the constant threat of imprisonment or deportation, as well as suffering the daily anxiety of being separated, in many cases, from their families. So what we have is what we call a vicious policy cycle of subsidized exports, leading to displacement of Mexican farmers, leading to out-migration, leading to criminalization. And this cycle continues as each term becomes accentuated because of the gap between the way that we're looking at these different policy areas, which are intrinsically linked. The other is the elimination of prohibition of government support programs under NAFTA free market rules in Mexico. Now here's where, again, subsistence farmers who may not be subject to the exportation terms have been very, very heavily affected. We just got in, just like yesterday, some preliminary results from surveys of 54 organizations in 19 different states in Mexico regarding what's the impact of NAFTA on your organization. These are small farmer organizations. And what would you have changed? And one of the biggest things that they talk about are the loss of these state programs and how that has made them prey not only to an international pricing system in which they cannot compete and which is not at all fair, even when you look at it in their own terms of free trade, but also to the loss of those programs of support. We'll talk a little about those at the end when we look at some of their recommendations of what needs to be done. And lastly, there's the increased use of water pesticides and agrotoxins in Mexican agriculture. The northern part of the country is now produced by transnational corporations that are producing large-scale amounts of grain there. They have really changed the agricultural model, and it uses intensively year-round irrigation and water in a semi-arid part of the world, as well as herbicides and pesticides. That is not at all sustainable from any way you look at it. Again, it's a vicious policy cycle that's using up the earth, that's causing displacement, that's causing criminalization. That's how Mexican farmers were affected, but then U.S. farmers didn't benefit from NAFTA either. This is something that I'm sure Patrick and Karen are going to talk more about. But what this is that the Mexicans complain that corn imports were dumped into their country with high U.S. subsidies. And in fact, subsidies averaged $16 billion a year from some statistics and studies from 2002 to 2007. And the total for all farm supports in Mexico was only $1.3 billion. In one of those years. But these billions of dollars are not helping family farmers either. Just quickly, the comment that was presented to USTR says, by prioritizing overproduction of U.S. agricultural products for trade, locks in a pattern of low farm pay prices and fails to address very real problems of farmers' ability to stay on the land. During NAFTA negotiations that began in the early 90s, many of us were around at that time, and there was a lot of skepticism between small farmers from both countries because Mexicans thought that the U.S. family farmers were reaping the benefits of this unfair system. And they rapidly realized that they had far more in common with U.S. family farmers than they had ever imagined. Why was that? It's because of who does win from this situation, which is the transnational corporations that we've talked about. So quickly going on to a beneficial trade agreement for small farmers, what UNORCA, the Regional Small Farmers Association, Chapingo University, the Agriculture University, and others are recommending is to remove basic foods from the agreement. Or, as it's stated more often here, replace that with a whole different type of an agreement that looks at reducing dependency of Mexico on U.S. surpluses, restoring and supporting local production. Inventory management and having national grain reserves. Right now, coyotes can go in, there's no storage facilities for small farmers. So the buyers can go in and offer any price, and they have to sell it because they have nothing else to do with it at that time. And they're subject to price manipulation by transnational corporations because of hoarding of grains, which are cases that we've seen in the past. They need long-term programs, multi-year planning, credit, effective rural development bank. They need to have no further intellectual property rules that would inhibit saving seed, which is critical to Mexican small farmers. And no new biotech applications that haven't been thoroughly studied in terms of social and environmental impact. Agriculture makes many contributions to society besides commodity production, employment and income, social security, stability, and especially in Mexico, and mechanisms of environmental biodiversity and scenery protection. It creates food cultures and preserves indigenous and human diversity as well. Food sovereignty has long been recognized as a critical element to national sovereignty, and Mexican farmers not only reject this asymmetrical trade that's taken place and destroys their livelihoods and their communities, they also reject being told that this is the only way. So now we have an opportunity to raise these issues and talk about what's needed, and this briefing is an important part of that process that I'm sure will go beyond this stage of the renegotiations. Thank you very much.
System of incentives basically requires overproduction. It requires farmers to seek new export markets to make up for prices that continue to fall. We need to break that cycle, but we think that perhaps starting with a better NAFTA would be one place to start. We certainly agree what the impacts have been on Mexican farmers and communities, but as Laura mentioned, they haven't been good for U.S. farmers either. Farm incomes in the U.S. have fallen by 50% in the last few years, and we're expecting prices to continue at very low levels for the foreseeable future. So some of us, U.S. groups working on food and farm issues, have been getting together to think about, really, what would this opportunity be? What should NAFTA be if we were to change it? These groups include the National Family Farm Coalition, the Rural Coalition, Western Organization of Resource Councils, Food and Water Watch, National Farmers Union, and RCAP. So we have this expanding group that are pretty coherent in our proposals. Now, we would start with two demands that I imagine will be shared by many organizations working on NAFTA. First, that the process must be made more transparent and negotiating texts published. And second, that it should eliminate investor-state dispute settlement, those corporate courts that allow corporations to sue governments over public interest laws. I think many organizations will be sharing those demands. We also have some specific proposals related to agriculture, basically to restore national sovereignty over food and farm policy, to reject harmful proposals from the TPP, and to ensure economic viability in rural communities. Now, on the theme of restoring national sovereignty over food policy, an important starting point would be to restore country of origin labeling, COOL, for meat. COOL was a program that was in place for several years that allowed consumers to know where their meat was coming from and help farmers get better prices. Canada and Mexico challenged that provision, that law, at the WTO, and they won. So a starting point here would be to urge Mexico and Canada to withdraw that complaint so we can restore consumers' right to know. On TPP proposals, I was at the International Trade Commission hearings on NAFTA earlier this week, and it was really striking to me how many businesses were saying, we need to start from many of the proposals that were in the TPP, but that was the low-hanging fruit, the basis for negotiations. It's as if a trade debate never happened in the campaign. It's as if TPP hadn't failed. Many of the same proposals that led to TPP's demise are now being advanced as the baseline for NAFTA renegotiation, and that's very dangerous. I would highlight three provisions related to agriculture. One would be to reject intellectual property rights provisions that limit farmers' ability to save and share seeds, reject market access rules on agricultural biotechnology, and stop trying to dismantle Canada's dairy supply management program. Ideally, we should all be striving for new programs that balance production and supply in more positive ways. As I said, we're very concerned that this reliance on TPP proposals will make things worse. And finally, in terms of ensuring economic viability, I would just say that we need to strengthen laws to prevent dumping. ITP has a new report calculating the extent of dumping of various farm goods. We found that in 2015, corn was exported at 12% below the cost of production, soy at 10%, and wheat at 32%. This is, of course, for farmers in Mexico, I would say in the United States as well. We could use anti-dumping mechanisms to start investigations of dumping of corn to Mexico, but also consider the impact of fruit and vegetable imports from Mexico to the United States. These are just a few ideas to start with, but the message I want to leave is that food and farm groups are coming together with very specific proposals in concert with the many other sectors that are working on it. So, thank you.
Especially have said a lot of what I was going to say. So I should be able to keep it short, but I'm also going to shift the focus a little bit more to the overall economy. A lot of people have tried to argue that NAFTA at least is good for Mexico because you had an increase in foreign investment that created jobs there. But when you look at the overall economy, it doesn't look anything like that, of course, including agriculture. Now, in terms of an overview, you have to remember that NAFTA was part of a whole change in economic policies that started in the 1980s. And it was pushed very hard from Washington. And this influence continues because the IMF is still very influential in Mexico today. And especially influential because Mexico has this special privilege that only three countries have, this flexible credit line. And the biggest in the world from the IMF of over $70 billion. And that gives the IMF a lot of leverage without even having to make any loans because they can take that away at any time. And you'll see that when I mention some of the policies today. But just going to the past, this whole period from 1980 can be looked at as a major economic failure. It was an experiment that failed. And it's true if you look just from 1984. So let me give you just some overall statistics. The most basic measure that economists have of economic progress with all its flaws is just GDP per person. And if you look at that, it grew by 97%, basically doubled. The average person's income doubled in Mexico from 1960 to 1980. And then things went south. So if you look at the post-NAFTA period, for example, 22 years from 1990, to 2016, income per person only grew by 28%. So the difference between 28 and 97% is very, very large and explains a lot of the political turmoil and discontent in Mexico. And in fact, if you take it from 1980, of course, it's much worse. That's when the whole experiment began. If you compare, the other way to compare is to look at Mexico compared to the rest of the region. So if you look at Mexico, again, just growth of real GDP per person, inflation adjusted GDP. From 1994 to 2016, Mexico ranks 15th this year out of 20 economies. And it's slowing now as well. It's projected to grow, the Mexican economy is projected to grow just 1.7%. If I have some time, I'll get into some of the reasons for that. So, Laura mentioned that there was a big surge of immigration. And she mentioned the poverty has actually gotten worse. And again, you can compare poverty to the rest of the region. It's a different measure than the Mexican poverty rate, so it shows a very slight decrease in poverty, but it's the rest of the region had, in the same period, a decrease of four times as much. So, you know, another measure also of child poverty is the stunting of children under five. Their growth is affected by malnutrition, and that is according to the Food and Agriculture Organization, that was 13.6% still in 2011. And it's interesting because at the other end of the spectrum, you still have, it's not the end of the spectrum, it's poor people too, you have an obesity epidemic. And there have been many articles about how the changes in NAFTA have contributed, changes from NAFTA contributed to that, because there was quite a bit of foreign direct investment in processed foods. Coca-Cola was one of the big examples, went from 298-ounce glasses a year to 745 from 1991 to 2014. And I think the U.S. was stabilized at around 400, which is probably still too much. But in any case, that was another impact. So again, the statistics, I won't go through too much more, just to mention that the, as Laura did, that the there was displacement in agriculture, 4.9 million jobs was the gross displacement. There was some, about 3 million jobs that were created in the agro-export sector, but of course a lot of the people who lost their jobs didn't get those jobs, and they weren't as they weren't year-round jobs, a lot of them. And so you still have a net loss of over 2 million, and that contributed, as Laura mentioned, to the big surge in immigration from 1994 to 2000, which then dropped off as the U.S. economy, you know, went into recession and had the Great Recession. It was not one of all the other shocks. So, I just want to end by saying, and people want to know more, we can talk about it in the question and answer, but there are a lot of vulnerabilities that Mexico still has that are not reflected in these statistics, from its being completely tied to the U.S. economy through NAFTA and these reforms. And you can see them today. In the last year and a half, the central bank has more than doubled interest rates from 3% to 7%. Why? Because the Fed has begun to raise interest rates here, and Mexico, because of a lot of the reforms that it made under NAFTA and other reasons, is extremely vulnerable to capital flight. And so they raise interest rates, and that is already slowing the economy. And you have all kinds of instability that is brought by this this very tight connection to the U.S. economy. And again, we can talk about that more if we have time. Thanks.
So thank you, everyone. My name is Abel Nunes. I'm the executive director of the Central American Resource Center, and I want to thank the congressman for putting this panel together. You know, and you know, I'll basically just talk about the unintended consequences of an economic sort of policy that has impacted us our day-to-day. And the congressman was very good about sort of the migration, the consequences of it. And I just want to start with a saying that a lot of people in not only Mexico, but the Central American region say, and it's, sin maíz, no hay país. Without corn, there's no country. It is one of the biggest staple crops that the country has. And so, and I remember as NAFTA was being proposed and negotiated and talked about, it was sort of this panacea of incredible wealth creation in all three nations that will elevate all boats, and then people will not have the need to migration. But the numbers show differently. So in terms of immigration, we need to go back to 1990, to pre-NAFTA, where, in the immigration sort of community, we talked about 2 to 3 million unauthorized immigrants in this country. So we came after IRCA in 1996 that legalized about 2 million, and those are the ones, and those are the numbers that we used to discuss. How are we going to cover 2 million? NAFTA gets signed, and it was an explosion of migration. Its peak went in 2007 when we talked about 12 million unauthorized immigrants, and half of those unauthorized immigrants were Mexican nationals. And so when we think about NAFTA, we have to think about the unintended consequences of that. So when you look at the numbers of unauthorized immigrants currently, more than 60% of all unauthorized immigrants have more than 10 years living in this country. That means that most of them are with a, it was the rush of NAFTA as they were being displaced. And so that people understand when the other panelists talked about the displacement in the agriculture sector in Mexico, it wasn't that the farm workers said, I'm going to the U.S., right? Because I think that there's a tendency to think that people automatically come to the U.S. for the wonderful benefits that we have here. But the reality is that most immigrants, one, do not know what the U.S. has. They just know they have to feed their families. And most of the workers first go to their city centers to look for employment. And when unable to find jobs, then that's when the flow happens. So I would say this, that it is, that if you think of NAFTA, did it create jobs? I would say it has. It has created a job, so that you understand, the ICE and Customs Border Patrol's budget has grown tenfold since 1993. The number of Border Patrol agents have grown at the border and the way they enforce laws. So to the extent that NAFTA can be negotiated or any other trade policies to be negotiated, it needs to take into account the flows of people, not just the flow of capital, right? And we need to also remember that NAFTA was not the end. In 2004, CAFTA was approved. So this is a model that will continue and that will continue to impact immigration, unauthorized immigration flows to the U.S. So if we are not willing to open a discussion on immigration and immigration reform, then as we're discussing policy, economic policy agreements, then it has to be part of the dialogue. So I'll leave it at that, and thank you very much.
Thanks so much, and thanks to Representative Patrick for having this important briefing. I'm Patrick with Food and Water Watch, and I want to talk a little bit about the American agricultural sector. We agree totally with everything the panelists have said. I mean, here in the U.S., NAFTA and trade generally are promoted as this magical benefit for agriculture, but it's important to recognize who benefits. It's the companies that benefit, not the farmers per se. The benefits are the big agribusinesses, the grain traders, the meat packers, the produce shippers, that buy and process and transport these goods. They get the lion's share of both the export benefits, and they also can stretch their supply chains across borders. What this does is it allows them to pit farmers against one another. Farmers here versus farmers in Mexico. Farmers here versus in Canada. And that allows them to push prices down, the price they pay to farmers, and increase their benefits. Remember, farmers don't export. The farmers don't export. They sell to a company that exports. And farmers receive really a pittance on the dollar of retail sales. In the U.S., farmers get about 14 cents out of every dollar you spend at the supermarket. And the same is true when they do the exporting. So it's a small slice of the benefit, but it's a huge slice of the risk, because the import competition of corn and soybeans in Mexico, of fruits and vegetables and beef in America, put tremendous pressure on farmers and push down the prices they receive and imperil their livelihood. Despite the hype on the charm offensive from big agribusiness, NAFTA has not actually been magically beneficial to the U.S. trade balance on agriculture. We had a double the agricultural trade balance with Canada and Mexico before NAFTA occurred than we do when we've had since. It was about $700 million a year. Now it's about $400 million a year. And in the last few years, with collapsing farm prices, that agricultural balance has turned into a massive deficit. Last year, we had a $6 billion agricultural trade deficit with Canada and Mexico. Largely, this is because of commodity prices. When corn prices go from $8 a bushel to $3 a bushel, the value of the exports just evaporates. And that means that benefit on the corn exports is no longer compensates from the colossal volume of imports on beef and produce. So look, it's also important to remember, it's not just about dollars, right? Because corn could be $6 a bushel, or it could be $3 a bushel, or $2 a bushel. The volume matters a lot. We have persistently imported more tons of beef than we've exported with our NAFTA partners. Since NAFTA went into effect, we've had a beef volume deficit with our NAFTA trade partners of over 800 million pounds. 800 million pounds. So that's a lot, right? And so what ends up happening for farmers is these imports compete against the price that they receive. In 2014, we imported 3 million more pounds of beef than we exported to the NAFTA partners. In 2016, we imported 340 million pounds more beef than we exported. And the farm gate price for fed cattle dropped by 20% in America. That's what happens. And who's doing this importing? JBS and Tyson and Smithfield. They're reaching across the border to buy beef, bring it here, and they use that to push down our domestic prices. That's what ADM and Cargill do with corn in Mexico, and that is the way the system is designed to work. They wrote the rules, they designed the system to create a race to the bottom for farmers, to pit farmers against one another, and it's working actually pretty well. So the bleakest portion of this is actually on the fruit and vegetable side. Before NAFTA went into effect, the International Trade Commission said, you know, imports aren't going to increase that much under NAFTA. But they've actually quadrupled. And last year, we imported 29 billion pounds of fruit, vegetable, and processed fruits and vegetables. It amounted to a $9.4 billion trade deficit in fresh and processed produce. And that changes what we eat. Before NAFTA went into effect, 90% of the fresh fruits and vegetables that Americans ate came from American farms. Today, 40% of the vegetables, over a third of the fruit, are imported. And on many things like tomatoes and peppers, it could be 60% or more. And so that's kind of changing. And the reason is the companies moved to take advantage of cheaper labor standards, cheaper occupational safety standards, weaker environmental rules, and ultimately the farmers here and the farmers in Mexico pay the brunt of this. So, look, I think we've talked a lot about, Karen talked about some of the things we support on what needs to happen going forwards, and those are incredibly important. We need to totally overhaul NAFTA on the agriculture side. It has done a great job of providing benefits to the companies on investment, on intellectual property, but it really needs to be reoriented to provide benefits to farmers and rural communities. Right now, we are in pretty much a global farm recession. Incomes are down 50%, crop prices are down 50%, and they're projected by USDA to stay that way for as far as the eye can see. So we don't need to double down on a corporate trade agenda that actually puts the companies first. It's time to put the farmers first and rural communities first. Thanks.
I just want to say thank you to all the panelists. This was very
approaching NAFTA for the first time. Do we have any questions? Can you just introduce yourself?
Yeah, of course. My name is Dylan Source. I'm an intern for a congressman from California. I actually have two prompt questions referencing what Patrick said recently. You said the food produce has decreased, imports have decreased in America, and the trade deficit has increased. So my question is twofold. One, did you guys take into account, by any chance, from 1994 to now, the increase of water regulations and environmental regulations and labor regulations in California, which is where most of the food and produce comes from? And the second thing is, you also said that it takes advantage of the different regulations and low labor standards in Mexico. So I'm kind of conflicted with what you guys are saying about people coming over from Mexico to the United States. If they go back, then wouldn't they be going back to lower labor standards and lower regulations, so our food would be coming from places with lower regulations? And I wonder if you guys could comment on that point.
Sure, I mean, I didn't take into account the change in regulatory standards, but the ultimate reality is the imports in produce have surged. They have changed the face of California agriculture from one of more diverse family fruit and vegetable farmers to more consolidated, much more corporate-owned land, much bigger operations producing one or two things. Look, before NAFTA went into effect, Green Giant shut down its plants in Watsonville, California, and moved them to northern Mexico. That just crushed a lot of jobs that were in those processing plants in the Central Valley, and it also meant that there were fewer places for farmers to sell to. Ultimately, this changed what was produced in the Central Valley, moving from a really diverse vegetable and fruit operation to much more specialized things, including lots of fruits that are grown by companies on company-owned land. The farmers that were displaced in Mexico were displaced all over the place because of the huge influx of cheap corn from the U.S. But ultimately, the production that was shipped to northern Mexico has hired some of those people. Look, this is pitting people against one another. The farm workers here are paid better than the farm workers in Mexico, and that is really saying something because working conditions here are appalling. So the working conditions, the safety of pesticide applications are better here, but they're not good here. So this allows the companies to pit workers against one another, to pit communities against one another, and pit farmers against one another.
I have a question for any of the panelists. My name is Natalie, and I'm from Congressman Kinzinger's office. So the environment has been on the multilateral agenda recently, and in any of your opinions, what sort of regulations do you think are important to include in these renegotiations? Anything from sustainable farming to transportation across large distances to deliver such foods to areas when we moved a lot of those practices to Mexico, so
more
closer to California, for example, farms?
I guess I would just say, I don't know, it's hard to know exactly how to go about it, but I would think that the most important thing is not so much including specific regulations on how to manage those problems within NAFTA, but allowing local governments the policy space to implement what makes sense. And so there's been, you know, a big part of NAFTA was eliminating that space, making those kinds of laws subject to challenge under these investor state dispute settlement cases, and more recently in TPP and also the TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade Investment Partnership, there were proposals on regulatory cooperation that also made it harder to get at new laws. So I think it's more sort of maintaining that space so that people can find solutions that work in their communities.
And I would just add that I also think it's taking a different starting point, which I think each of us has addressed in different ways, that the starting point should not be big business, corporate agribusiness. Rather, we should look at the needs of society. And Pope Francis's point that we've got to have the economy serve the people, not people serve the economy, which we have right now. And so if we look at a common good idea, how can business benefit, but how can the people benefit as well? And I think it's that different starting point then that includes care for the earth. And if we look at it from the human
the dollar signs, then I think we get more creative in our approach to solving these problems. Because if we don't leave a world where we can grow things, land that is nutritious and not, you know, poison, we're not going to have food for the future. So I think it behooves us to pay attention to the societal context and start there, then deal with it.
Thank you. My name is Kendra Benton, and I'm with Witness for Peace. My question is for Ms. Carlson. You mentioned water pesticides and agrotoxins. In a renegotiated NAFTA, what types of environmental provisions do you think are needed, and what types of enforcement mechanisms do you think can be used to prevent the use of certain pesticides?
There has to be, agriculture has to be part of the agreement, not in the side agreement, which has been in which it does not have sanctions and has been basically worthless, especially in the context where Mexico is, it has oriented their economy to seek foreign investment at all costs, basically. They're willing, even the regulations that they have, they will set aside in enforcement terms in order to make the deal more enticing for transnational companies that want to produce there. Now, it again gets back also to the policy space, and that's why we have to have a whole different framework. The list of programs that included in the recommendations, many of them are illegal under Mexican law. Just in the last month or so, an agroecology network of small farmers has been formed in Mexico because they take the they take the issue very seriously. But when they're in a regimen that only values lower prices and lower prices and lower prices for producers, while the people who actually do the exchanges are making all the money, they're unable to bring those values to the fore in public policy. So those would be two important things: stricter regulations and enforcement, and the policy space.
My name is Dominic Benedetti. And a couple of you guys talked about focusing on immigration when we come to the renegotiations. And I'm just kind of wondering, in the face of an administration that's trying to further crack down on immigration, what are the specifics we should be looking for in an after renegotiation to not only prevent furthering the problems it's created, but also help to fix some of the problems that it's already caused? Because I don't think we can just say stop with it, but also how do we try to
I would say that part of the negotiation is to understand that this will have an impact on immigration, and you can't put provisions in that impact immigration in the terms of allow visas for displaced workers. And most of the displaced workers come here to work on farms, so there has to be a way to address that. Because if not, the only way we're confronting the issue is to add more money at Border Patrol, because the issue of the wall or enforcement is not, it did not start with this administration. There was a virtual wall that was discussed in 2005. The budget has gone for border enforcement from $360 million to $3.8 billion. That's money that could be redeployed for other programs. So I think that part of the discussion means that you cannot assume that the market itself will address the immigration issue, that the actual policy needs to address.
Yeah, I just want to add that, ultimately the Mexican people are going to have to elect a government that will fix their own economy so that people won't be so desperate to leave. And I think that, if you look at the statistics I was talking about, for example, if the Mexican economy had simply continued to grow post-1980 the way it grew in the 60s and 70s and even 50s, Mexico would have the income of a country like Portugal, that are basically European living standards, and people wouldn't be wanting to come here, for the, much smaller difference in income. And so, I think one of the main things is we have to make sure that our policies here, including NAFTA, don't actively prevent Mexico from pursuing the kind of development policies that it had pre-1980 and pre-NAFTA.
We have time for one more question. Hi, my name is Caroline. I'm with the Law Firm of Working Group. I'm wondering if any panelists can speak to the connection between NAFTA and farm trade, economic displacement, and loss of livelihood.
Yeah, that's another one of the vicious policy cycles in incidents, which is definitely the other recommendation, is that immigration must form part of an immigration agreement. This is not just trade, it's trade investment, it's an integration agreement, and it was absurd and unprecedented to have left it out in the first place. Labor flows are quickly affected. In terms of the organized crime, the other vicious policy cycle is precisely that, by driving people out of basic foods production because they've got lower producer prices. What we've seen is, for example, poppy cultivation grew from 5,000 hectares in 95 to 32,000 in 2016. This is largely led by demand in the United States, but it also makes it much more easy for organized crime to recruit producers and to find land to grow on when basic crops don't provide a living, and also to recruit young people who don't have employment in the rural sector to work in all capacities of organized crime. So again, we're seeing policies by punishing Mexico in the trade agreement that are feeding organized crime. And then Mexico gets punished again as supposedly the source of organized crime in the United States. It doesn't make any sense.
Can I just add from the perspective of the state of Michoacán County, one of the real challenges has been the militarization of the police. And with the militarization of the police, the narcos armed themselves to defend themselves from the police. And then you have families who get weaponry from the United States, and that's where most of the guns come from, and they get caught in the economic pressure of trying to survive. And so this is another failed policy, is this whole idea of arming the police as being the way forward, when we know that that generates action-reaction. It's a vicious cycle that's got to be addressed and stopped. But we don't seem to be thinking outside the box on many of these topics, which is quite worrisome, which is why renegotiating NAFTA from these very original starting principles is a recipe for disaster. We've got to stop it.
All right. Thank you guys for coming, and thank you again.